Well, hello there, you malt Mickey Mousers. Ralphie here with Whisky Review 157. And we're continuing our run on American spirits with one of the higher specification bourbons by Jim Beam Brands Limited. Distilled at Claremont Distillery in Kentucky. Interesting one this, in that Jim Beam are stating that they are trying to reproduce a bourbon from pre-prohibition times. So it's supposed to reflect yesteryear. I doubt this very much, because modern production techniques, modern grain varieties, modern machinery and mechanisation, chill filtration and all the rest of it, I really don't think that allows a proper old time bourbon to be represented here. I think if you want to find one, maybe you'll try Heaven Hill or Dickel. I think that's about as near as you're going to get, unless you know someone with a big garage and a power supply and a copper utensil. By the way, thanks to George for the lovely card, there we go, of the San Francisco cable car. They work in pulley systems, so that all round the network there's a literally one pulley, a steel rope underneath the road, which is constantly circulating, and the cable cars operate by clamping on and unclamping from these cables. It's a fairly unique system, guys, and if you are in San Fran, check it out. I've been there, and they do some pretty good chocolate, amongst other things. Although, fingers crossed, there wasn't an earthquake at the time. Water. Now, this is bottled at 50% volume alcohol, over 100 proof. It is 9 years old. They claim it is a small batch bourbon, but you need to know something, guys. When is small batch small batch? How small is small batch? How small does it get? Or how big can small be? Yeah, I know. It's never really entirely made clear. If you come across a single barrel bourbon or Tennessee whiskey, depending on the producer, it can genuinely be a single barrel in the bottle. But a single barrel can be several barrels, 10, 20, 30 barrels put together technically. And small batches are roughly the same. You know, it's whatever the producer wants it to be. Technically, small batch should be, and I'm taking my advice here from one of the small independent Scotch whisky producers who told me, and I do value his opinion, that small batch, you know, 10 barrels. Once you put 10 casks together into one vat prior to bottling, you can retain the individual signature of what's there. Any more than 10 barrels and things start to get just a little bit vague, a little bit out of focus. Okay, okay. So I don't know how small the small batch is, but it does say in the side, hand bottled. Okay, right, whatever that means. I'm sure it'll still be producing a production line of some sort. In a limited quantity. How limited is limited? I don't think it's that limited. For superior taste and smoothness. Right, let's check out the superior taste and smoothness. Now, being 50%, I'm going to add a spoon of water using this international unit of measurement here. Now notice, only one, because when I was coming up to this review, I was tasting this whiskey and thinking, at 50%, this should be seriously strong flavoured, but it isn't. You could actually drink it neat. So there's actually quite a lot of neutrality within this, although it's a flavoursome spirit. There is that neutral side to it, so be aware of that. Now, interestingly, I didn't notice that a few years ago when I first came across Knob Creek. So let's see how we get on now. Tasting notes. After all the pelters, yeah, I got for racing through the tasting notes of Elijah Craig, I'm going to slow things down a little, take my time with this one. Nose. Syrup. That's the first thing. There's a sweet, heavy, sweet, oaky syrup. Clove, slight, coriander. I'm giving a rose hip. I don't know if you know rose hips. Becoming prominent. There's certainly cherry cola and boiled sugar sweets and seaside rock. Now, the cherry cola, there was something else with it that I couldn't quite pin down. Reaching off camera here. Dandelion and burdock, known in America as root beer. That features as a note in this whiskey. I'll just hold the bottle up close so you can see it. There we go. Watch out for flat-sided bottles. If we take the rather over-sweetened sibling of junior sibling of Knob Creek, round bottles, you can bang them about. You can even drop them in a carpet. But don't even try it with flat-sided bottles. Flat glass is weak glass. It's like a plate glass window. So, we're not going to drop our bottles anyway, are we? If we do, guys, it means you're either drunk or extremely coordinated. Taste. Initially, dry and bitter and tannic, like stewed tea. Lapsang souchong, but quite one-dimensional. And then the water, just a drop of water, releases fudginess, vanilla, wintergreen, which is dentist's mouthwash, a wood syrup, resin, raisin, camphor, definitely camphor, touch of violets in the background, a dull, and I do mean a dull rye, some lime leaf, and again, you get a little touch in the finish of what you got on the nose, the cherry cola root beer. Finish, flattish and bitter. Right, this is certainly not up to the standard of bottles a few years ago. That surprises me because generally American spirits have really come ahead in the last 10 years. There seems to be quite a revival going on. But this one, there are better ones out there, and bear in mind I was using the Elijah Craig as my benchmark, baseline bourbon, 82 out of 100. There you go. And that, my mateys, is a bourbon mark. So, hopefully you found this useful. Well, for a start, I'm slowing down my nosing and tasting notes, so I hope that helps you. And come back shortly when I'll be moving on to my next bourbon stroke Tennessee whiskey. Ralphie.com. See you soon.